Hello, everybody, and welcome back. I have a special treat for you guys today, and I think this video will come across very helpful to some of you guys that are having a little bit of difficulty moving your properties in certain areas, especially if you're starting wholesaling, especially in virtual markets. So this hack I'm going to show you is actually using your purchase contracts and limited power of attorneys, also known as special power of attorneys, or specific power of attorneys to list your properties on the MLS. And I've been able to do this over the years. And really, I've been able to move properties that my competitors have not been able to move. We're in the business of helping out people as wholesalers. And we need to have all the tools in our tool belt that we can use at our disposal to get deals to close for certain sellers. So in certain situations, you could use a purchase contract and not list it on the MLS to move your deals. However, there may be certain situations where you need to do this, and you may be able to close a deal over your competitors by using some of these tactics. So I want to go ahead and jump into this video, but before I do, I need to make a legal disclaimer that I'm not an attorney. If you're going to use these documents, guys, I highly recommend you running them by your closing attorney or real estate attorney. I haven't personally encountered any legal issues doing this, but every state's MLS and county's laws are different. I don't want to speak for everybody. However, I don't think you'll run across any issues, but I just really need to say that because I don't want any sort of legal blowback. So now that we have that out of the way, let's go ahead and talk about why we use purchase contracts to list properties on the MLS. Guys, this is the best way to get access to the most legitimate and serious cash buyers in your market. When I first started, I had to build a buyer's list from scratch because I didn't know this particular hack that you can do. And I was sending out letters and postcards to buyers that bought in the area. I remember I sent a few postcards out, actually several postcards out, but I only got a few phone calls back from buyers because just like with sellers, you know, you're going to have a certain number of responses per direct mail campaign. And even though those buyers were legitimate and they were buying a lot of deals in the area, it's mail and mail gets lost. People don't respond back. So I think we sent off like 1,000 postcards and only got 10 buyers every time we sent that out. That's a very slow way to build your buyers list. And if you're just starting out, I know me and my business partner, we could not afford to have that long period of time between getting a deal and then slowly building our buyers list. We really need it to turn a profit and quickly. And this will help you guys do this. And I'm actually going to put in the description all of these contracts that I'm going to discuss that you guys can download and use today. So purchase contracts, we have an MLS clause in it that allows us to list our properties on the MLS. You want to do this because most of your buyers, your serious buyers, have agents scouring the MLS for them. Why are agents doing this for buyers? Simply because if they provide a buyer a deeply discounted property that needs to be flipped, guess what happens in 2 or 3 months after they complete that renovation? That buyer is going to use that realtor, our agent, our broker to list their house. So it's advantageous for both parties to work together and for the agents to send these deals to the buyers. And this is another reason why if you're trying to find deals and you're starting out, say you're not wholesaling but flipping, and you look on Zillow and you never see any good deals, it's because all of these are pretty much pocket listings and they may not even make it to the MLS. If they make it to the MLS, they will be snatched up very quickly if they are in fact 50 cents on a dollar or deeply discounted for that particular market. However, I would say a lot of these deals that get sent to agents, say I'm a seller and I have a property that I want to move and I know it needs a lot of work, I may work with an agent and tell them, hey, just move this deal and I don't even want you to list it. And they probably can do that. So this isn't really good if you're looking to buy properties because there's a lot of competition. However, we are on the opposite end and looking to sell. So we have access to a lot of buyers in this particular situation. So let's go ahead and talk about a few common issues you will encounter when trying to list your properties. And these are very common. And I want you guys to know these issues that you'll come across and certain things that you'll hear so you won't get discouraged. Because for one, this is not illegal. I've done this in multiple states. I've done this in Florida, I've listed properties in South Carolina, Georgia, North Carolina, and Texas, and probably a few others. Basically, where most of the active real estate markets are, I've listed properties there with no issues. So if a realtor is trying to tell you that this is illegal, it's not. Just because they don't teach in realtor school does not mean that it's illegal. And always remember, guys, the confused mind says no. So it's easier to say no than to understand what you're trying to do here. When people try to be creative and stuff, people think that it's illegal what you're doing. But I'll be honest, all the money I've made, like the biggest checks I've made, have been made in the gray area. You know, not illegal, of course. I would not do anything illegal, but you're trying to do stuff specifically by the book, you're going to be behind, because you have to realize the gatekeepers here in this world, and I'm going to go in a different direction here for a second, so just go with me. But I strongly believe a lot of the gatekeepers in this world, they're not going to sit here and tell you exactly the exact path to make $100,000. Why? Because they need you to work in their Fortune 500 companies. Why are they going to give you the secrets? So you have to take some risk. And if you're not comfortable taking a risk, then this isn't for you. But if you do want to make some money and really get access to a lot of buyers and not have a lot of resistance when you go into new markets, then this is for you. Let's talk about some of the issues that you guys will encounter. First off, we need to be speaking to brokers, not agents. When you reach out to an individual to list your house with your purchase contract, you need to be talking to the actual owner of a brokerage. And I prefer working with smaller brokerages because I prefer to work with smaller local brokerages. Why do I do this? Because these individuals are competing with the big players like Keller Williams, REMAX, and Coldwell Banker, and the list goes on. So a smaller brokerage will want to work with local investors just because it's advantageous for them to have that type of relationship. And on top of that, if you approach them with 10 listings a month at a $300 flat fee that you're paying them to list these properties, that's $3,000. That can pay for their marketing expenses. That can pay for a lot of things, especially with a smaller brokerage. So just realize that if you're going to do this, I wouldn't go to like a Keller Williams, a REMAX, or anything like that. That's not going to work. You want to go with a smaller broker, and you do not want to talk to an agent. And I have a video, and I'll link that in the description, with networking with agents and moving your properties through agents using the MLS. And I'm saying agents and brokers interchangeably, but just know that you got to talk to the actual owner. And it's okay if you get an agent on the phone, but I would just say, hey, present this to your broker and see what they say. They can't make this decision. They're going to say, well, I need to check with my broker. So you might as well just bypass them. Brokers are the owners. Agents are the employees. So you want to be talking to the owner. I hope I drove that point home. So one thing you'll hear a lot of people say is if you call some agents or brokers, is that this is illegal. It's not. It can be argued that you have equitable interest in this property as soon as the seller signs a contract. And on top of that, it says rather egregiously on the contract that we are listing this property on the MLS, or we have that option to list it if we want to. And I'll show you that purchase contract in a second. So when we talk about compensation, guys, we do not want to cut the man a percentage of the commission, because let's just say we have a $10,000 assignment fee and we're making a 10 grand assignment fee on a $300,000 house. Well, if we're paying them 3% commission, that pretty much wipes out all of our assignment fee. So I try to stray away from that and just have them list the properties on the MLS. And really, that's the only thing they're doing. It will probably take them an hour or two just to take that property, put it on the MLS, and I have them forward me all of the buyers. Like, everything goes straight to me. Nothing goes to them. And I tell them that up front. Hey, you will not show this house. You will not do anything after you list this property on the MLS. The only thing that you're doing is listing it, and I'm handling everything else after that. And when we close a deal, just remove it from the MLS. That's it. And when you position it like that, they understand it. See, this is unconventional, so you have to explain it and you have to know what you're talking about. And if you sound unconfident, you can't just assume that they're going to fill in those gaps and understand what you're trying to do. So approach them very confidently, understand this concept, and understand any potential rebuttals that they may have. But really, it's very straightforward. Another issue that you guys may encounter is that these realtors, brokers, or agents may not want to make it a pocket listing. So a pocket listing means that this is not syndicated to Zillow, Redfin, and Craigslist. If we do it that way, then there's a potential that the seller will see the deal. And that just defeats the purpose of us listing it on the MLS. We're not doing anything unethical, but I don't tell my sellers that, hey, I'm going to wholesale this deal, even though it's on the contract. I go into the deals thinking that, hey, if it's a great deal and I'm able to get private money, I'll flip it. But I haven't had that situation because it's just a lot easier to wholesale them. So they don't need to know all the intricacies and everything that's going on the back end. Just know that if you are going to go this route, make it a pocket listing. Just list on the MLS. Do not list on Zillow, Redfin, and Craigslist. You can do that yourself. But to get access to that MLS, you're going to want to go through a broker that can do this for you. And I've actually had situations where sellers saw my deals on Zillow and it's killed my deals. So if you're going to advertise your property, you might as well just do it on the MLS and not do it on Zillow, because you're going to get a lot of tire kickers. I do that for some properties, but really, if I'm going to put it out there to anybody else other than my buyers list, I'm just going to go through the MLS, because those buyers that are on Zillow, Redfin, and Craigslist are going to be on the MLS anyway, and they're going to be vetted by those realtors. So it just eliminates a lot of tire kickers, and anybody that calls you, you can pretty much bet that they're serious, and you don't have to vet them as much as well, which is another good thing. On Zillow, you have to be very careful because there are a lot of pretenders, not a lot of people there that actually can perform. I can't tell you the countless number of buyers I talked to that said they have deep pockets, or I'm looking to buy 100 properties this year. Okay, dude, whatever. It doesn't mean anything to me until you sign my contract and put down my earnest money deposit. And another note here on the compensation structure and why you want to work with local brokers, especially if you're in a competitive market, is that these brokers in these competitive markets are vying for the attention and business of the homeowners in these bigger markets. So what they're having to do, because these bigger brokers are focused on volume, is they're going from 3% listing commissions to only taking 2% or maybe even 1% or 1.5%. So as a local broker, if I'm them, I'm thinking, how do I increase my profit margins? How do I get more money in? And this is an excellent way to do that and help them out. And they would be appreciative of this. If they're having to undercut their commissions, this could sort of pad that for them and just allow them to get more income. So please just work with local brokers. That's the best way to do this. And lastly, when it comes to the purchase contracts, understand that it will defeat the purpose if the broker wants the seller to sign off on them listing it for them. Because if the broker says, well, I can list it on the MLS, but I need the seller to sign off on it, I mean, what's the point of you even going with them and listing it? It's so the seller doesn't know. Like I said, we're not doing anything illegal, but it's just, you just don't want the seller doing that, because then they're going to say, well, I thought you were the buyer. Hey, I'll close on it if need be. And then I'll list it on the MLS and I'll wholesale it if need be. But this just allows me to move the deal. I'm going to exhaust all of the things that I can do on my end to move this property, because at the end of the day, the seller just wants to get paid. They don't need to know all this stuff on the back end. I know if I go to a car dealership and I see their profit and I see how much they're making, I know they're making a profit, but I don't need to see all that. Same thing here. The seller is forfeiting a bit of their equity for convenience. So the less that you involve them in knowing a lot of this stuff, the better. Trust me, they don't want to know. But if you start getting scary and acting all timid and stuff, like you're doing something wrong, then that seller is going to pick up on it. You're not doing anything wrong. You have every right to do this and list this property on the MLS. And I'm actually going to talk to you guys here shortly about specific power of attorneys, special power of attorneys, or limited power of attorneys. It goes by multiple names depending on the state or county you're in. But if you're uncomfortable using your purchase contract, you can use that. And we'll discuss that here shortly. but understand if you're going to list your properties on the MLS, do not work with a broker or agent that wants the seller to sign off on you listing it. It completely defeats the purpose of us doing this. So let's go ahead and take a look at that purchase contract. So as I discussed, this is in the description. And again, I want to reiterate before you use this, guys, make sure you run it by your legal counsel. So here's the clause that I use in my purchase contracts that allows me to list my properties on the MLS. This right here is so simple. The buyer has the right to show and market the property to a third party assignee. The buyer has the right to market the property in any way, including but not limited to placing the property on the MLS with a licensed agent or broker, Zillow, Craigslist, and similar house buying websites. Once your seller signs up, guys, you're good to go. You just need to find an agent or broker that will list this for you. And that's where a little bit of the difficulty comes from. But if you go on Zillow and you look up the most active agents or brokers in your market, I don't think you'll get past the first two pages without finding somebody that may consider this. And if not, we have a specific power of attorney or special power of attorney that definitely will allow you to do that without any sort of resistance. So let's go ahead and take a look at what that is. Let's talk about limited POAs. It goes by multiple names. It could be called a limited power of attorney, a special power of attorney, or a specific power of attorney. Back when I was doing this, I called them specific power of attorneys just because that's the language that my attorney told me to use. However, upon researching this before I created this video, I think limited is actually more well-known and used. So if you're going to do this, I probably would just put limited, but they're all the same thing. So look at a limited power of attorney as you being a family member and helping out this individual sell their house. You don't have to be a family member to get power of attorney. However, in most situations, a power of attorney is given to a family member. Now, a limited power of attorney differs from a general power of attorney because you are only able to make decisions on behalf of the homeowner for this particular house and any other assets that they indicate. So they can say, hey, I want CC Garland to be my attorney, in fact, on 123 Main Street, and also with selling this boat. As long as this information is indicated on the power of attorney and filed at your county's courthouse, then you will not have any issue working with third parties on behalf of your seller to dispose of their assets. It's important for you to understand the difference and to be able to explain this to the sellers because some might hear power of attorney and think that you're taking over all their assets. That's a general power of attorney. We're using a limited power of attorney. And it expires at a certain date as well. This actually makes the sellers feel a little bit better about signing it. And you'll still get some resistance, guys. So I wouldn't do this off the bat. You're going to have really good rapport with the sellers to do this. Don't just say, hey, I'm going to send you over a limited power of attorney to buy your house. There has to be some reason why you're doing this, or else it doesn't really make sense to them. If you feel uncomfortable using a purchase contract to list your properties on the MLS, then you have to explain your case as to why you are using a limited power of attorney for your seller. So in certain situations, it actually makes sense. And really, it is a lot easier on the seller to move their property if they use this. I'm telling you guys, it has made my life so much easier in really complicated deals. I'll give you guys an example, or a couple examples here. So in one situation, I had a seller that was a recluse and she did not ever come out of her house she was living in. She didn't live in the one that we sold. She actually lived right down the road from it, but she just let the property go in a state of disrepair. She had some psychological stuff going on too because her husband passed away about, I think, 5 years before we went and contracted this property. In this situation, she got behind on her payments and actually owed the bank a lot of money and was facing foreclosure. We actually were able to close on this property, I think, a week before the actual auction date. But see, I was able to do this because I got a limited power of attorney. I had her sign off on that, and then I was able to use that to get her to sign a bank authorization letter with the bank. So I had these two pieces of information. So I had these two documents and I gave that to the bank and I was able to call on her behalf without her being on the phone. So that's huge, because I probably talked to that bank 50, 60 times over the course of trying to wholesale this property. We negotiated this lien down a little bit, and we were able to push back the foreclosure date. So if I didn't have this power of attorney, I would not have been able to talk to her bank or the attorney that was filing the foreclosure. So in this situation, if I just had a purchase contract, I'd have to have that seller on the phone every single time I had to contact a third party. And there would have been no way she wanted to do that, because she just would have let it go to foreclosure. But we're here to help people, and we're here to provide a service. And this is one way that you can provide a service to sellers that are really in a difficult situation. Another situation I encountered where I use a specific power of attorney was an individual, actually a husband and wife. And the wife was really sick. The husband was older. He was taking care of her. And he had 26 parcels in this area in Charleston. And we didn't know what was going on with him as far as the title was concerned. So we were able to do our own due diligence and not have to contact them every time we needed to contact the county about a property or the attorney about a property. There was actually one parcel where we had to do a lot of work on with cleaning up the title before we were able to wholesale it, because the closing attorney that closed on that deal like two decades ago didn't properly file the deeds. So there was a lapse in the deed on the county website. So it looked like it was granted to the seller previously in like 1960. And then there was just like a gap from 1960 to 2004, which was just ridiculous. So that was really bad on that attorney's part. But anyway, we had to clear that up. And same thing with the previous seller I mentioned. If we had to get this seller on the phone every time we needed to talk to an attorney or somebody about that property, he would not have wanted to work with us. And there would have been no way that he would have sold these properties. He just would have threw his hands up and said, you know what, I'll just let the properties go into a state of disrepair and I just won't pay the taxes. And for me, we saw opportunity. We're here to help sellers, guys. I hope you're understanding what I'm saying here. You can use this to really change your sellers' lives and get them out of situations that are very difficult. As wholesalers, we should be running towards these situations, not running away from them. This is where we make our money, and this is where we make a lot of money. Some of my biggest deals have been really complicated. Anybody could give a seller a purchase contract on a property that's in a great location but needs repair work. It helps now, especially with more investors entering in the wholesale market and the investment space, to have multiple tools at your disposal. And this is definitely one that you want to have in your back pocket. As I indicated previously, if you are uncomfortable with getting a purchase contract signed with that MLS clause in it, or if you're encountering issues with realtors not wanting to list your properties, then get this specific power of attorney. You're going to have to get it notarized and filed at the courthouse for it to be a legitimate document and for you to be able to actually list it. But once you have that thing filed at the courthouse, guys, you're good to go. It is so easy. This is your golden ticket at that point. It is fun because you can literally do anything and not have to worry about contacting the seller. Now, we're not going to do anything unethical. Realize that you have a lot of power here. I mean, you can literally sell the property for a dollar. You can deed it in your name. Don't do that, guys. Obviously, be ethical about this. Understand that you are taking on their asset. You are their attorney, in fact. So treat it as such. Treat this seriously. And if you do that, you will be compensated nicely for your skills and for what you're doing. So let's go ahead and take a look at what this specific power of attorney looks like. I'm going to show you guys a blank version of it, and that will be in the description as well, so you can download that. And I'll also show you guys two completed ones. So let's go ahead and look at these documents. Okay, so this is what a limited power of attorney looks like. And the information that's actually in the bold are things you're going to need to change. To start off, you're going to have your state here and the county that the property is in. And your seller's name is actually going to go here. And your name is going to go here. So the seller's name is going to go here and your name is going to go here. not your LLC name. And here's where you put the address of the property. So the complete address of the property and the price you're buying it for. So the same as a purchase contract. This is what you're contracting the property for. And so since we're filing this and we don't want to go and file amendments and stuff, make sure you're settled on that purchase price before you file this at the courthouse. To do an amendment and all that stuff, it just would take a lot of work. So just make sure you get that down with the seller and you don't plan on renegotiating that price at a later date. And so here is actually that price again. And you're going to want to put that same price listed here in this spot right here. So any proceeds above, let's just say $100,000 will be dispersed to your LLC. So this is basically indicating any profit. So when you go and assign this property, you're going to make. So if you sell this on the MLS to Joe Buyer for $110,000, anything over that $100,000 is yours and it's yours to keep. So you'll put your LLC name here as well as right here. And you'll put the power of attorney date to expire. You could do 90 days from the date you fill out this document. You could do 6 months, a year. It's really not that big of a deal with the date here. I would put it far out though. It's better to be conservative with these things because if you're using a power of attorney like this, then there might be situations that come up that may delay the closing. So 90 days is really the minimum I would use. 6 months is what I would feel comfortable with just in case anything happens down the road and it pushes that closing date back. And this is really important, guys. We need to get the actual legal description from our county's tax site or register of deeds. And I'll show you guys shortly how to get that information. Here's the area where your notary will fill out the information and they handle all that. So you'll need to get this notarized. And once you get this thing notarized, just file at your courthouse and you are good to go. You could give this to any agent or realtor or broker and they cannot tell you that you cannot list this house because legally you are representing your seller as their attorney in fact. So let's go ahead and look at what a completed specific power of attorney looks like. This is it. We have the seller's name here. My business partner at the time was Ethan Summers. So he worked with all the sellers. I did a lot of the backend stuff. He talked to the sellers, which made sense for him to be the attorney. In fact, it didn't make sense for both of us to, which is why his name's listed here. And then this is a property, 881 Ashley Avenue. And the amount we contracted it for was $100,000. And anything above that, we were owed. Now, we actually had to go back and amend this. Or I think we even just wrote a new power of attorney up once we found out that she was very far behind on her loans. So this power of attorney allowed us to get that information from the bank. And we knew at that point $100,000 was too low. And we needed to get this property under contract for, I think, $200,000. She owed quite a bit on this property, but we paid her exactly what her loan payoff was. And we had our expiration date here. Now, we got this straight from the county website. We copy and pasted it. I think we actually had to go down to the courthouse because at the time, this information was not available online because this deed was recorded before our county went digital. So we actually had to go to the county courthouse, look up the deed information, and write it on here. So you need to have that there because this is very important. So there's no confusion as to what that particular property you're getting under contract and putting this power of attorney in for with the county. So it's very important that you have the specific word by word, line by line, legal description here of that particular parcel or property you're working with. We had our notary sign, David Gibson, and we had another witness. So the notary was one of the witnesses, and we had our acquisitions manager at the time be another witness to sign this. So everything's up above board. This is a legitimate document, and we filed it at the courthouse. All right, and lastly, I want to show you guys this specific power of attorney we filed for a seller where his wife was sick and he had multiple parcels he needed to move. I mentioned this a little bit earlier in this video. In this situation, we had multiple properties. So instead of listing all the properties here line by line, we indicated to see Exhibit A. So we attach an exhibit. And so all this stuff was signed. Like I said, I couldn't find the actual one we filed at the courthouse. It probably is on the register of deeds, but I didn't have this at the time of posting this video. But this is basically how it looked, other than the notary block right here where everything was signed. So if we go to the next page, we will be able to see Exhibit A that includes all of the property addresses we were getting under contract and their legal descriptions as well. So in total, this was 4 pages. And our attorney helped us with this as well. We had a great relationship with him by this point, and he really helped us out. We were really green. We were new wholesalers, and we were doing this, and this was very complicated to me at the time. But this is how I earned my stripes, because doing all this complicated stuff at first actually made wholesaling so much easier down the road. And now I'm going to show you guys how to actually locate this information on your county's website. So the legal description is what we need. Here is the legal description for one of the parcels in that 26 parcel deal that I just showed you guys. So they changed up the county's layout here since I started real estate back in 2016. So this information actually was a lot longer, but this will probably suffice. But really though, if you want to be absolutely certain that you are getting all the information properly documented on your power of attorney, because it is a pain to redo this stuff. I've had to redo it multiple times. It's just a process to go down to the courthouse and file the document again and amend the power of attorney. It could just waste a lot of time. So make sure you're getting the legal description properly. So the people that are working at your county office, or register of deeds, they actually won't let you file the power of attorney unless it actually has the information needed on it specifically. You might be able to get away with a short description like this. If not, they'll point you in the right direction to get that info. Never hesitate to ask them, because this is what they do all the time. And I want to go ahead and show you guys what it actually looks like when it is registered. Here is the individual, Ronald Wilson, we were working with. So once your document is filed at the courthouse, it will be registered. And we can probably go to the second page here and see some information here. See, okay, so P/ATTY. And here it is. So this was for one property. And this seller, he had like 30 lots in total between himself, his wife, and his son. So we had to do 3 separate power of attorneys. It was a messy deal. We made a good bit of money on it for it being our first deal, but it was a lot of work. And at the end of all of this, I felt like I knew so much about this process that I probably could have gotten a job as a paralegal at a law firm. Seriously. So just understand that this is important to know, and ask for help if you guys are getting lost here. It's very important. If you want to get to this page that I'm at, you're going to want to go to your county's register of deeds and your property search. So I'll show you guys how to do that here. So I'm just going to type here, Charleston County property search. And this is the one that came up. And so I just simply typed in the address. I think the address I was looking at here was 2430 Meeting Street Road. So I just put that there, click search. Details came up, and boom, there it is. And then if we want to find the actual register of deeds, so when it's actually recorded, or if we need to get these documents at a later date, then we will go and go to the register of deeds. And you may be able to find the information regarding the legal description here. It just all depends. So I'm going to go to document search. And in here, in my particular county, we need to search it by the individual's last name and first name and the recording date. So I just do 1/1/1900 so I can get any documents that come. So I do it from 1900 to now. And then I click search, and it's going to show me everything. So Ronald Wilson is a really common name, so I need to make sure I'm looking at the right individual. So Ronald Wilson and any of his properties in Union Heights, I know are his. I think there are a few here from another Ronald Wilson, like this Ronald G. Wilson. That isn't him. So just make sure you're searching for the right individual. These county sites can be so different. I wish they would just standardize this across the country. There are some that use the same software and the same backend server. So I think they're getting to the point where they're getting standardized, but you might have to search around a little bit. But guys, like I said, don't hesitate to call the county. They're here to help you and serve you. They want to help investors because investors help make the community look good. So they want to help us out. Have these things in your tool belts, guys. I hope this video helps out. If you need me to clarify anything, I can definitely make another video on this topic. I understand I threw a lot at you guys, but please rewatch it if you're not understanding. And if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to ask me. I hope you guys have a great day, and I hope you guys are able to use this to contract some properties and make some money.